Chelsea Bay is a massive landform extending over 7 kilometers in length and almost 4 kilometers wide. The basin, located in Fillmore County, Nebraska, has the typical southwest orientation of the Nebraska Rainwater Basins. Welcome to another edition of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we study the secondary impacts made by the glacier ice boulders that were ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. This LiDAR image covers an area of 20 kilometers by 40 kilometers, or 800 square kilometers, around Geneva, Nebraska. Several Nebraska rainwater basins can be seen clearly. There is a link to the LiDAR visualization tool for Google Earth by Michael Davias in the description of the video. Michael Davias named this landform after a cemetery located on the northern rim, which services a populated place just to the west. The sandy, well-drained rims of the Carolina Bays are commonly utilized as cemetery sites. The northern half of the bay is farmed, and the grid of pivot irrigation plots is continuous across the rims, suggesting that the slightly elevated rims of the bays do not present an impediment to the farming activity. Nebraska's roads form squares with size of 1 mile, and each square mile has 4 pivot irrigation systems. The LiDAR images are created with a 20 times elevation exaggeration, so the sharply defined rims in the LiDAR images are difficult to perceive by the human eye from ground level. This image shows the transect of Chelsea Bay. The rim on the southwest side of the bay, indicated by the arrows, is 10 meters above the bay floor. The thickened rims at the southwest end of the Nebraska rainwater basins is similar to the thickened rims on the southeast side of the Carolina Bays. The new version of the LiDAR images colors the topography with a spectrum that repeats every 10 meters of elevation, and the colors change every meter to provide significant contrast for small changes in vertical elevation. This basin has not been identified as a rainwater basin, probably because of the extensive natural drainage across the landform. The floor of the basin is heavily eroded by the South Fork Turkey Creek. Fitting an ellipse to Chelsea Bay, we notice that the ellipse fits the northern rim of the bay well, but the southeast portion of the bay has some high terrain which is not expected for a structure that originated as an inclined conical cavity and reduced its depth by viscous relaxation as proposed by the glacier ice impact hypothesis. The width of the bay is 4,100 meters and its length is 7,550 meters. That is 7.5 kilometers or 4.7 miles. It is truly huge. The angle of impact calculated from the width to length ratio is 32.9 degrees. Estimating the projectile diameter as 1/5 of the bay length indicates that the ice projectile that made the bay had a diameter of 1,510 meters. That is 1.5 kilometers. In English, that is almost a mile wide. Chelsea Bay is located 1,210 kilometers from Saginaw Bay, which is assumed to be the point from which the ice pieces were launched. Using ballistic equations, we calculate that the impact velocity was 3.6 kilometers per second. The time of flight was 6.66 minutes and the trajectory height was 197 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. This is a suborbital space flight in the vacuum of space. The kinetic energy of such an impact is 2,560 megatons of TNT. That is absolutely incredible. I had to widen the columns of the spreadsheet that I used for my calculations because the numbers were so large. It would have been impossible to survive the horrific ballistic sedimentation in Nebraska. Let us take a closer look at the unusual high terrain that is within the southeast portion of this bay. From the colors of the topography, we can see a sand ridge that is 9 meters higher than the bay floor within the elliptical area of the bay. This is seldom seen. The floor of the bay is 482 meters above sea level, and the sand ridge is at 491 meters above sea level. The fluvial channels within the bay have caused significant erosion of the bay floor. The arrows indicate the direction of water flow. One of the streams comes from the southeast and crosses the location where the rim should be. Perhaps this water flow helped to shift the high sand ridge into the bay. It is also possible that the erosion within the bay created the weakness that caused the southeast rim to slump inward toward the terrain at lower elevation. We also need to consider that an impact adjacent to the large bay could have shifted the rim. It is a complex problem and we may never know the answer. The terrain in Nebraska is not flat like the Atlantic coastal plain. This causes the rain to flow along the surface instead of through underground aquifers. The flow of water along the ground erodes the fragile sandy structures. Every time that I calculate the energy of the impacts that made the Carolina Bays or the Nebraska Rainwater Basins, my mind struggles to comprehend the violence and carnage that was delivered by the secondary impacts of the ejecta of the extraterrestrial impact. You simply cannot outrun or hide from a chunk of ice with a diameter of 1.5 kilometers, coming at you at a speed of 3.6 kilometers per second. Sometimes I think that the Carolina Bays and the Nebraska Rainwater Basins are the graves of our ancestors, but that is wrong. Our ancestors were very, very far away from here, and they survived the Younger Dryas to give us life. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Nebraska Rainwater Basins. I will continue to examine the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays.